Thanks so much, Monica, for that introduction, and also thank you to the organizers of this webinar for the opportunity to speak with you today. I'm super excited that so many public health professionals and especially local health department staff and officials are starting to pay more attention to climate change. I actually got interested in climate change when I was working for a small local health jurisdiction, the city of Berkeley, and the mayor invited me to give a talk at a public forum on the health impacts of climate change. And at that time, my work was really focused on how to address health inequities in chronic disease in our African American community in the city. And I kind of looked at the mayor like, huh? And started reading up to prepare for this forum. And I was really taken aback for two reasons. One, that I had not previously paid any attention to this issue. And two, because all of the causes, upstream causes, the causes of the causes that we were looking at in terms of health inequities in our own community and the causes of climate change overlapped, and thus the interventions overlapped. So that was how I got started on my trajectory. And what I want to do today is very briefly give you a very quick overview of the highlights from several of four major recent reports that address the impacts of climate change on health, and then move into talking a little bit more about, from my perspective, what local health departments and public health professionals can do. And just to note that there's also a whole variety of information that you can access if you are not already familiar with it about Ontario climate change and Canadian climate change. And I think that perhaps Helen will address some of those in more detail. So first, the International Panel on Climate Change, thousands of climate scientists and other scientists around the globe issued a special report on global warming of 1.5 degrees. And that report really reminds us how much more warming the Earth reaches beyond the current 1 degree above pre-industrial levels is up to us, that every additional amount of warming makes a huge difference, and that we have only a very short window of time in which there is still opportunity to keep warming below 1.5 degrees, the level that most climate scientists now feel is the level we need to stay below to avoid the most catastrophic effects of climate change. The IPCC also points out that climate change is already affecting human health, that it disproportionately affects the disadvantaged and vulnerable populations, both within countries and increases global health inequities. That the greater the warming, the greater the risk to health, and that there's a very strong public health case to be made for limiting warming to the greatest extent possible. It documents that the health gains from actions to limit warming have very positive health impacts, many of them, and that the speed at which we reduce our greenhouse gas emissions will affect the level of adaptation required to reduce health harm. So the speed and magnitude of the actions we take now will really impact the health outcomes in the years to come. The Lancet Countdown represents an international multidisciplinary research collaboration that publishes annual reports tracking 41 climate and health indicators. And in their 2018 report, their key messages are that current climate impacts on health in the form of heat, labor capacity, vector-borne disease, and perhaps most importantly, food security or food insecurity are early warnings of the potentially overwhelming public health impact if temperatures keep rising. Lancet reiterates the IPCC warning that climate exacerbates health and social inequities within and among countries, And it really highlights the fact that greater public and policymaker understanding that climate change is a central public health issue is crucial to garner the response we need to avert climate chaos. And that response necessitates transformation in our energy systems, our transportation and land use systems, our food and agriculture systems, and our health systems. That's where the connections between climate change and health inequity become so apparent, because when we think about how transportation impacts health in terms of creating sedentary lifestyles, air pollution, noise, or when we think about how industrialized agriculture and overnutrition in the developed, much of the developed world has led to obesity and cardiovascular disease, or how air pollution from power generation, especially coal, has led to respiratory and cardiovascular disease and impacts on children. If we tackle those root causes of climate change, we tackle some of our greatest public health challenges, including inequities and chronic diseases. I want to point out that Dr. Courtney Howard from the Canadian Association of Physicians in the Environment and many of her colleagues produced a special Lancet countdown briefing that summarizes the many ways in which climate is already impacting the health of Canadians and makes a number of recommendations for Canadian policymakers. So I commend that report to you and appreciate the work that Courtney and Kate have been doing in this arena. The World Health Organization issued a special report that was released at COP24, the last round of international climate negotiations in Poland last December. That report says that a changing, more variable climate is now recognized as the most likely, highest impact global risk to society as a whole and presents a clear and present danger to health security. They again indicate that every delay in action increases risks, that the speed of emissions reductions directly impacts health, and the World Health Organization also points out that it's often local authorities and local health departments who have responsibility for the health of communities and local authorities that have responsibility for the systems that need transformation to address the challenge, like what happens with local transportation. WHO makes a strong case for the role of a health in all policies approach in which the health implications of decisions in all public policies are accounted for and the health benefits optimized. And since we all know that most of our local public health agencies don't have the power to change our agriculture system or change our energy system alone, that our efforts as local health and state health agencies to really work with and in collaboration with all these other sectors is the only way that we can address the root causes of health inequities or of climate change. And finally, the World Health Organization report discusses the need for broad public support and community engagement to effectively tackle climate change and the urgent need for greater engagement of the health sector as advocates for climate action. So let's review what the reports all said. First, climate change is impacting our health now. The warmer it gets, the worse it will get. Climate actions have tremendous health benefits. We need to adapt regardless of mitigation actions. And failure to take transformative action across many of our most basic systems with great urgency risks catastrophic effects on human health and well-being and possibly on the survival of human civilization. In other words, climate change is a global health emergency. Unfortunately, atmospheric carbon dioxide levels are now the highest they've been in at least the last 800,000 years, and probably closer to 2 million years. That's why the World Health Organization's Director General recently said, quote, "We cannot sleepwalk through this health emergency any longer." Youth around the world know this, and thousands are striking every Friday from school Greta Thunberg, a 15-year-old leader of this youth movement, says the same thing in a different way. Why should any young person be made to study for a future when no one is doing enough to save that future, when the most important findings given by the finest scientists are ignored by our politicians, who say you love your children above all else, and yet you are stealing their future in front of their very eyes? The main students in Canada and other countries that are joining this youth-led movement, and health professionals and health organizations are growing their own movement to respond to climate change. Last September at the Global Climate and Health Forum in San Francisco that was affiliated with a Global Climate Action Summit, dozens of health organizations from around the world, including several from Canada, endorsed a call to action on climate and health that outlined 10 priority actions to address the climate crisis and move toward a vision of healthy people in healthy places on a healthy planet. I think you're all familiar with the social determinants rainbow, and it's the healthy planet piece that's missing from that rainbow that we really need to think about how we add, because we can't have healthy people or healthy places without having a healthy planet. Just a few weeks ago, Canada's leading health organizations issued a similar call to action, urging Canada's political parties to develop climate action plans and timelines to minimize warming to 1.5 degrees and to minimize the health impacts of climate change. In January, over 30 health organizations in California issued a call to action. That included our California Conference of Local Health Officers, the Health Officers Association of California, the California Conference of Directors of Environmental Health, and many others. And we outlined, again, 10 priority actions and identified what we thought were sort of some of the specific actions in California context that could be taken by the state to both simultaneously address climate change and reduce health inequities and address chronic illness. So I'm not going to go through all of these, but I did want to highlight that our 10th priority action was investing in climate and health, starting with support for local health departments. So why did we include a specific recommendation on allocating resources to local health departments? We included it because we see local health departments as an essential piece of any effective health response to climate change. Local health departments are on the front lines responding to wildfires and heat waves and floods. They work in the most impacted and vulnerable communities. They are trusted and credible in those communities. So they really are an essential part of making sure that we respond to climate change. But of course, as probably most of you can tell me, most local health departments have little experience, capacity, or resources to take on climate change. So at least in my experience here in the US, local health workers are constantly asking me, what can we do? We don't have any resources. We don't have background in this. They didn't train us on this in public health school or in medical school, so we're not sure what we should do. And the answer, I think, is that local health departments can do what we've always done, educate communities about health risks and how to reduce them, identify groups that are at the greatest risk, collect and track and analyze and share data on our environment, on disease risks, on the occurrence of disease, model health impacts and forecast them, mobilize partnerships in the community with the private sector across government, analyze the health and equity benefits of proposed policy actions, including through implementing health and all policies, work groups or task forces or commissions in your local jurisdiction. Preparedness and response, taking into mind the increased risk for extreme events with climate change, and promoting workforce development to increase our capacity. So these are things we do for all the health risks that public health departments address. We can do them for climate change too. The challenge is that since few local health departments have specific funding for climate change, and at least here in the U.S., there's very little likelihood that we're going to get that funding in the near future, given the totally reactionary stance of our federal government on this issue. We need to think about how we can integrate climate into our existing work. So I want to share with you just a really quick snapshot of what some local health departments in the U.S. are doing. We ran a learning collaborative for local health departments over about the last 3 years. Maricopa, which is in Phoenix, not known for its progressive politics, started by doing a home health survey to assess the capacity of homebound individuals to respond to heat waves. And then they used that to launch an intersectoral effort, starting with a public symposium and then leading to a strategic plan for climate change and health that had very wide stakeholder buy-in. Contra Costa County, just north of where I am in Oakland, and the home of a number of very large oil refineries, conducted an assessment of the health co-benefits of their county's climate action plan. In Oregon, the health department did a health impact assessment of the effects of rail transport of coal through Multnomah County, with recommendations really that would reduce coal transport in that area. Los Angeles County has convened a multi-agency sort of health and all policies work group to develop an urban heat island reduction plan, really specifying what planning, public works, the parks department, and so on can all do to reduce exposure to heat in densely populated areas. Salt Lake City convenes annual climate and health symposia. And in California, the directors of local environmental health departments worked with us to develop guidance on safe surplus food donation and trained hundreds of local restaurant inspectors all over the state on how to support the reduction of food waste in restaurants and other large food facilities and why it's so important to do so in order to reduce organics in the waste stream that lead to methane pollution, methane being a very potent short-lived climate pollutant. San Francisco has developed a bunch of vulnerability assessments for heat and flooding. San Luis Obispo integrated climate change into its nutrition education programs for mothers and children. Philadelphia integrated climate change into materials that they've produced on asthma for children. Minneapolis mapped flood vulnerability and then used those maps to conduct community resilience workshops to really inform the community and also to get community input about what they felt they needed from the Minneapolis local government to improve their capacity to respond and also to build neighborhood cohesion. Many local health departments are working with the state health department in California to project the health impacts of increasing bicycling and walking and using that information to impact regional transportation plans and sustainable community strategies planning. Again, Public Health Seattle King County interviewed key stakeholders, both within government and external community groups. They surveyed their own staff and they used that information to help develop a blueprint for addressing climate change and health that they are now implementing. So I want to close by sharing with you a relatively new resource that I hope will help you all build upon the work that you already do every day in your local health agencies to give climate change the attention that it really requires urgently. This guide for local health departments is premised on our view that local health departments are unlikely to suddenly get a huge infusion of money to address this issue, but that because it's a health emergency, we don't have a choice. So it's not a comprehensive catalog of everything you can do on climate change, and it's not a step-by-step how-to, It's intended to let people that work at the local level in public health integrate climate change into their public health practice and to enter from wherever they're interested. We've worked with health departments where it was the maternal and child health coordinator who was the most interested, and they needed to find a way to intervene within their current programmatic work. We found other health departments where it's somebody in the epidemiology program that's the most interested. Our view is that no matter where you start, there's something you can do to address climate change and use that to engage other people in your community, in your management, in your peer group, and in other agencies to start addressing this critical health emergency. The guide is grounded in the core concept that health equity and climate change are inextricably interlinked, that the same societal structures and systems, starting at the uppermost end with racism and other isms and wealth inequities, and then looking at the systems such as transportation, agriculture, energy, food, and so on. Those structures and systems that cause health inequities are also causing climate change. And there's a whole range of health interventions and climate actions from the most upstream to the most downstream at the point of climate disaster response that can reduce the health harms of climate change, reduce health inequities, and promote health. Building political and economic power and voice are essential components of that process, because without that, we will not get the kind of transformational systems and structural change that we need to avert climate chaos. The guide provides a very brief overview of climate science, reviews the health impacts of climate change through the lens of heat, wildfire, drought, etc., talks about the health benefits of climate action in energy, agriculture, transportation, and green infrastructure, and then explores what local health departments can do from the perspective of various programs, such as maternal and child health, or chronic disease, or clinical services, or from the perspective of various public health functions, such as surveillance or community engagement. And finally, there's a section on climate and health communication. Each section identifies possible local health department actions in four categories: surveillance, intersectoral collaboration, preparedness, and community engagement. And I'm not expecting you to be able to look at this right now. I'm just giving you a sense of what's in the guide. The program and function sections start with a brief section on why climate change should matter to you if, for example, you work in maternal, child, and adolescent health. You know, we know, for example, that infants, children, and perinatal women are among the most vulnerable to the health impacts of climate change for a variety of reasons. For example, extreme heat or increased ozone levels. We then provide a lot of different examples of what local health departments can do in the particular program or function area. Each section, you know, both the impact sections and the program sections have a piece about climate change and equity, and specifically talk about why a particular group or a particular impact may disproportionately affect certain populations or groups. We have spotlights, for example, school health programs, what can they do on climate change, and we have a lot of vignettes of what local health departments are already doing to integrate climate change into their work. And then finally, the climate and health communications chapter really tries to take what we've learned about how we best communicate about health inequities and layer on climate change perspective. So my colleague in the Public Health Institute at Berkeley Media Studies Group, Lori Dorfman, who I credit for almost this entire chapter in terms of teaching me about this, really talks about the importance of first helping people understand that a particular health problem has roots not in individual behavior, but in people's environments and the systems and structures that surround them. In other words, triggering a we're all in this together perspective. And then making sure that we provide a sense for people that, that our values are concordant with theirs, and talking about the solution as much as we talk about the problem. It's really important that we talk about climate change to people so that we normalize talking about it, and so that we start to provide people with opportunities to talk with others in the communities about it and demand action. In the communication section, we also provide a lot of examples where we took press releases or outreach materials from local health departments across the U.S. and just tried to show how without a lot of change to what we do every day in local health departments, we could start to let people know that climate change impacts every aspect of what we do in public health. So just for example, in the original heat press release, it says high temperatures need to be taken very seriously, people should protect themselves and watch out for others, et cetera, et cetera. We just add a phrase, high temperatures need to be taken very seriously, especially since climate change is making our summers hotter. I know that Helen's going to talk more about some of your local resources and guidelines that relate to these issues, and I want to just alert you to the fact that in addition to the guide for local health departments, our Climate Health Connect website has a bunch of other materials. It's got a physician's guide that's more clinically oriented, posters on climate change and health, some information that goes into more detail on the co-benefits of, for example, changing our transportation system, and a guide for state and local governments on health and all policies. And the lessons we've learned from the California Health and All Policy Task Force. So I will stop there, and I hope that we have time for questions either now or after the next presentation. Thank you so much.
Hey, this is Monica back again. Thanks so much, Linda. We're going to save questions until after the next presentation. We've had a lot coming in, and we're just putting them all together, and then we'll be going through them, and there'll be lots of time for questions.